Actually, I may need to give you a signal to sort of put that up on as needed. Thank you all for joining the Linux Australia Annual General Meeting this afternoon. I was making some jokes earlier about the irony of the NTP part of the sysadmin conference being the bit that ran late, but we'll move on that. All right, so without further ado, we will formally start the meeting. And again, my thanks to all of you for attending and for the conference organisers for affording us the time and space to hold the Linux Australia Annual General Meeting. I didn't realise when I took on the presidential role that I actually needed to chair this. Had I known, I mean, really. So the first order of business is a motion from Hugh Blemmings, that would be me, that we the minutes of the Annual General Meeting of 2016, so that's the previous AGM, be accepted as complete and accurate. I'd welcome a seconder if someone feels comfortable to do so. Thank you, Chris Neugebauer. And we will vote on that motion as the next bit. So if all in favour, if I could trouble you to raise your hand. Anyone against? Nothing seen. Anyone that would wish us to abstain? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Counting about six abstentions. My thanks to Sarah for the minute taking. On to the next order of business, which is to receive reports of activities from the preceding year from the various office bearers. And mine is the first as president. I circulated the president's report on the Linux Announce and Linux Oz mailing list about a week, 2 weeks ago now, so I shan't insult your intelligence by reading the whole thing verbatim, but I will just note a couple of points as we go along. This has been my first term as president of Linux Australia, and having been involved in the council in various different capacities in the past, I'd really do mean it quite seriously when I say I view the opportunity to serve in this particular capacity as a privilege. It's a wonderful community that we have, not without our quirks at times, but to be able to assist, if even in this modest way, has really been quite a privilege, and I thank the community for that. I've also had the good fortune, as I note in my report, to work alongside an excellent council, and I thank all of them for their contribution. And it would be remiss, obviously, not to thank the broader community for the great work we do as a broader group of people contributing to the Free Software Commons. It's a really great bunch of people across the board that we work with, and I thank all of you for your part in that. Has been a slightly challenging year at times, and I won't spoil my afternoon or yours by dwelling on those over much, but on the plus side, I think it's also provided an opportunity for us as a council, as individuals, and perhaps as a broader community to improve and reflect on the various lessons learnt from that. We ran a bunch of events. They were all excellent. They all returned at least a modest profit, in some cases quite a substantial one. Of course, that's not the driving reason we run the events, but it is nice to allow our coffers to be enhanced each year to allow us to do two various other things. One thing I did want to call out, there was no OSDC event in 2016. We would welcome bids, or the future council, I expect, will welcome bids for an OSDC event. So I did just want to call out, that's not because we don't care about OSDC, but just that there wasn't a bid put forward and therefore no ability to run one. I noted in my report that we had three grants, or three major grants that we put out during the course of the year, which, doing a little bit of maths, is about $20,000 in total. As I note there, while our coffers are by no means bottomless, we do have a reasonable amount of money available to us to contribute to good projects or good endeavours, and we'd certainly welcome submissions for that in the future. Bit of a different year, or a busy year for subcommittees. We formed the Treasury and Finance Subcommittee, a group that have been charged with essentially providing a pipeline for us to grow our own treasurers, or train our own treasurers, might be a better way to, less awkward way to put it. Gives us an ability to not only train in-house treasurers to work with the organisation, but given that the organisation side and our ongoing cash flow, we are actually talking about reasonably large sums of money, so a good degree of prudence is appropriate, and having a broader group of people whose expertise we can draw on to manage that is certainly useful. Membership Subcommittee was another group that we pulled together to look at how we run our membership platform, the overall picture for us membership-wise, both in terms of number of people, about 1,000, a little over 1,000 based on our current reckoning, and what tools we use to more efficiently run our membership platform in the future. The final, but by no means least important piece of this, while it's not a subcommittee as such, we're also in the process of pulling together a group of individuals that we can draw on as a council when we have issues that we need some guidance on the best way to, in terms of language and responses we have when things do pop up that need a more careful and more measured response. I'm also pleased to report that we expect during the course of next year that following a decision made by the Linux Users of Victoria to do so, they'll be coming a subcommittee under Linux Australia, and we certainly look forward to welcoming them to the fold. Other subcommittee reports there which I draw your attention to, again this email is on the list if you do wish to follow it up. LinuxConf AU bids, we had, we're at one of them obviously at the moment. Preparations are well and truly underway for the 2018 event at an as yet undisclosed city, but that will be revealed shortly during the course of this week. Also pleased to report that barring anything very unforeseen, we've got a very strong bid for 2019 in a particularly nice part of the world, so that will be good as well. More details on all those to follow. Membership and other statistics, just briefly, I touched on these previously, about 1,000 members. There is also a particularly attractive and informative infographic which Cathy put together, which you may wish to have a look at. In terms of advocacy and government submissions, we put forward a number of submissions to the Australian Government over a couple of various topics. Noteworthy in these is that these were largely the product of volunteers outside the council who did the lion's share of the work to pull these together, to research them. We're very grateful for their inputs, but I think it's also a very good demonstration of the way we as a broader community can work with council to efficiently produce outcomes from Linux Australia as an organisation. I particularly note Josh Stewart and Kim Weatherall for their work on those two events. There's also a letter that we'll be signing in February next month to the Productivity Commission into fair use, along with a number of quite noteworthy other organisations. Just to speak very briefly on the challenges front, we had a number of my fellow council members who were unable to contribute to their council duties as much as they would have liked, and I guess for want of a better way to put it, this was largely due to asynchronous or unexpected events, and that did impact our ability to perhaps execute on as much as we would have liked to through the year. Indeed, for my part, I had a expected absence at the start of the year, doing something very different to free software. But if we take all this in totality, it really did mean that a lot of the day-to-day operation of the council did fall down to a couple of our key office holders to keep things ticking over. I sort of prompted myself or preempted myself a little bit in the closing comments, but I guess just to reiterate, it has been a joy and a privilege, as I see it, to serve in this capacity and to work for the community this way. It is a little bit of an unusual way to close a document like this by saying I hope this is my last term as president, not because I shy away from the duties, but rather we have a very capable vice president or president in waiting who I hope the community will have got behind and will have supported us, and Cathy in particular has a very strong vision for where we can go with Linux Australia, and I hope as a broader community we can execute on that. Thank you all for your attention for my report. I shall hand over without any further ado to our... I'm out of time. That's it. It looks like we're done. Next up we have, I believe, our Treasurer's report. Yes, wherever Tony is. So I'll hand you over to Tony Breeds. Please welcome Tony to the stage.
This report will be relatively brief. There's a lot of interesting things in there, and I'll talk about them as I go along. As I was on the council last year, I'd like to say that the council left the books in pretty good condition, and there weren't any unforeseen external events that forced us to change our tact. Most of our business relationships have stayed the same, actually all of them. Still use the ones that are outlined there for auditors, accountants, Xero, and our banks. We ran a number of events that Hugh has already talked about. And the bottom line is, due to the strong performance of these events, our profit and loss for the reporting year, which ended on September 30, was $184,000 profit. Now, there's a big caveat there. It's a little bit ambiguous there, but GovHack, which was one of our subcommittees, due to the way they run their events, they don't align with our financial year very well. So we got all of their income in the financial year I'm reporting on, and most of their expenses are in next year. So their event is going to look very poor if you just look at the bottom line next year. It's going to have a huge expense and not very much income, but you're all smart people. You'll deal with that. In the last couple of years, the Treasurer's report has looked back on some of the to-do items. They haven't really changed very much. We want to look at cancelling our GitHub subscription just because it's considered not necessarily well aligned with our ideals, and it's money we could use. Verified by Visa membership, which we don't use very well. One of the things Francois suggested was looking at using separate Xero accounts for our New Zealand events, because then the GST reporting and the base currency is in New Zealand dollars instead of Australian dollars, and that can simplify some things. But don't clap. You're not going to like what I say next. And revisit our ANZ accounts, because currently our Westpac accounts require two council members to sign off on transactions. ANZ only requires one. We've made small amounts of progress on three of those four items. We haven't done anything about removing the verified by Visa because it just didn't bubble up the priority list. The forward progress we made on the other items is not because we actually progressed them, but we did other things that showed us that maybe those things aren't actually things we want to do. So looking ahead, obviously I didn't nominate for treasurer again going forward, so I will not be the treasurer. Not be on council, so I'm hesitant to lay down direction or suggestions for the incoming council. But if I was on the council, I would seriously look at whether we continue to use ANZ at all for our New Zealand accounts. I've had significant issues trying to get access to those accounts, and they're just uninterested in helping. So maybe we want to look elsewhere. On the split Xero front, we did have a split Xero instance. We had Linux Australia in one and all of the GovHack accounts in a second one, and organizationally that is an unforeseen burden. It's really quite challenging to deal with that. Now, the New Zealand thing might work out differently, but I would hesitate to do that thing without very deep consideration about splitting the accounts and what that would mean for the organization. This is our 2016 budget. There's some very large numbers in there. You can see that we actually budgeted to make a small loss based on the income, but the numbers get quite scarily large. The numbers I'll call out there specifically, we didn't do a member DB hackfest or hosting thing, so that just became a null item. We spent considerably more on bank fees. It's actually not quite true. We accounted for our bank fees differently, so they show up as a different line item, which is why the bank fees are $3,000 more than we budgeted. we spent more on software donations and, sponsorship donations and grants. That was after the council looked at the large amount of income we got from other events. We decided that was a worthy goal. You can see that some of our conferences made very significant profits. PyCon specifically made over $60,000, which was nearly 10 times the amount that they were expecting to make. So we're in a fairly good position there. We have not moved a budget for the 2017 financial year. I look to the next treasurer to do that. And I'd just like to finish up with a thanks specifically to Kathy and the members of the Treasury and Finance Subcommittee, because they've done excellent work. When, as Hugh mentioned, some of us have had unexpected absences, they've really stepped up and done awesome work there. Thank you.
Thanks, Tony. Next order of business is our Secretary's report from Sarah Domain. Thank you.
Thank you. So 2016 was a pretty run-of-the-mill year. We had one face-to-face meeting and 23 teleconferences. Quorum was achieved at each of them, which is great. So we're still holding the record. The numbers for the membership are slightly different because I'm going off the member DB, not off the MailChimp list, and we have 3,598, and there was a 9% growth in the last year. And it is suggested that we move to something a bit more user-friendly because at the moment we're unable to renew memberships and all that sort of thing. Media and communications was handled by the media team this year, so their report is on the mailing list. Please feel free to go there. And the correspondence, there was a lot of checks this year due to GovHack, but there was also a lot of termination requests for membership due to the membership renewal survey. And we also signed, as Hugh said, the open letter, and there was a volume of support requests as well on how to install various things. There was also a significant amount of correspondence due to the VPAC closure and the statement regarding Jacob Applebaum. And that's my quick and crazy report.
Thanks, Sarah. Right. We have a couple of motions now. This is some of the procedural parts of proceedings. First of all, I would welcome a motion for that the auditor's report is a true statement of financial accounts.
Present the auditor's report.
Oh. Thank you all for paying attention. You all passed the test perfectly. Sorry, Chris, did you have a question or were you...
Yes, it was sent to the mailing list, but it was held up in moderation due to the fact it was large.
I don't actually know what I need to present here. This is the auditor's report. It is conducted by a third-party certified practicing accountant. He goes through our books to check for irregularities and so forth. His method is outlined in the bottom of the report. So you can see here his view on our income and so forth relative to 2015. I'll point out that he's looking at the actual transactions that take place in zero during the financial year, whereas some of the budgeting and projections we do take into account that we budgeted to spend money, we just didn't get around to doing it until maybe slightly outside of the financial year. You can see here that the GovHack revenue that I talked about before is the majority of the difference between 2015 and 2016. Our expenditure is mostly in line with previous years. And again, due to the GovHack expense versus revenue set up, he says that our profit was just over $1 million this year, which is a very scary number. Linux Australia typically doesn't hold assets, so that's why that number is very low. That's the what the statement showed at the end of the financial year as being our financial balance. And then this is the details about the method that the audit report is generated via. That shows where the funds actually are. That's an alternate view. And that's the statement that we need to sign shortly. So it does. We will get an amendment. Yep. He always does that. All right. Thank you very much. And now we will go back to Hugh so that he can move the motions. If I could work a computer, I could do that thing. That's by the committee. That's the last page. Okay. Cue. Totally legit.
So noting that we have a couple of typographical level corrections to make to the document, which I think are reasonably uncontentious, and as I understand the legality of such documents, as long as they're appropriately initialed, we can change dates and so forth without causing a... And I'm getting vigorous shaking of heads from a number of people in the room who I believe to know these things in some detail. So would someone care to put a motion then for the... So motion was moved by Joshua Hesketh and seconded by, I'm sorry, thank you, Craigie. McWhirter.
Sorry, it was a trick question, I can't see.
Oh. All right. Can I, we should probably vote on that, I guess, shall we? Would that be customary? So we have a motion then that the auditor's report is a true statement of financial accounts. We've had that moved and seconded. If I could have a vote for people who are comfortable to vote in favour of that, please. Thank you. Any against? None seen. Any abstentions? 2, 3, 4. Four abstentions. Thank you. Next motion, if I could have one from the floor, please, is that the office bearers' reports are correct. That's the president, secretary, and treasurer's reports. It's like bingo. moved by Chris Neugebauer. Thank you, Chris. And seconded by Peter Chubb. Thank you, Peter. Could I have a show of hands to in favour of those, please? I beg your pardon. The motion was that the office bearers' reports are correct. I'm just following the piece of paper. All right, so let's keep things moving on. Can we have a motion? So what's the conclusion? We should do all three separately? Sorry? Okay, so if I could please have a motion that the president's report is correct. Neil was first, Chris seconded, thank you. We'll vote on them all together, is that acceptable? No. Okay. Neil Cox moved. Christopher Neugebauer seconded. I believe it will be uncontentious to vote on all of them simultaneously. So, unless I... Yeah. Indeed. So, a quick show of hands to accept in favour. Thank you. any against? Any abstentions? I guess just me. Three abstentions. Second motion relating to the office bearer's report then is the treasurer's report. If I could have someone to... Michael Still, because he'd be very unhappy and never let it live it down if he can't. Would someone... Sheree is seconding, I believe. Sheree Ellis seconding. Voting all in favour, please. Any... any against? And any abstentions? One, two, three-ish, three and a half abstentions. And the final procedural motion relating to office bearer's report that the peer buys an enormous round of drinks at this. I'm dying up here. A motion, please, that the secretary's report is correct and is Pia War, seconded by David Bell. All in favour? Any against? Any abstentions? One, two, three. Lowest rate of abstentions yet. All right. Thank you. Right, so I believe the next item on the agenda is to consider items tabled in the call for agenda items. We didn't receive any on the mailing list, so there's no specific action to be taken there. Item 5 on the agenda is to hear and respond to questions from the floor. Are there any questions from the floor? And if there are, we may need to get a microphone to you. Mr. Hesk, right.
I've got one mic. There's a second mic here, so I can run over.
I was going to get some exercise.
Thank you very much, Hugh. This is a question for the Treasurer's report. Sorry, Tony.
It's all right. At least you don't have to hand the microphone.
Would you be able to pull up the budget again for us, please? I have a question regarding the GovHack profit. What you described made sense in the audit to me. I just want to clarify a question in the budget. I haven't got to the question.
Is that the one you wanted?
Yes, thank you. So GovHack is shown there as receiving 5,000 in profit. No, that's revenue, sorry.
That's right, because we will not keep the profits from the GovHack event.
Okay, so you've adjusted for what will be returned to the event.
That's right.
Or the end assuming, also the expenses, I'm assuming.
That's right.
Okay, thank you.
That's per the agreement we initiated when GovHack came on board.
Hey, Tony. What do you do with the profit from GovHack if we don't retain it?
It goes into running future GovHack events.
Oh, okay. So we're effectively holding it in trust?
Effectively, yes.
Okay. So we don't build a big pile and burn it like the KLF did or anything like that?
No.
Okay. Cool. Just checking.
Linux Australia does not build big piles of money and burn them.
Sure. Paul Waper, question for the President. Just wondering if there have been any, or how has our relation with SLUG and the other TASLUG and the other LUGs that are now subcommittees gone? I recall when this was initially proposed that people were wondering whether the LUGs would be changed by this process. So I'm wondering to know if they actually have.
I think to the extent they've changed, it's been a positive one. My read of the reports we'd had back were, it all seems to have been a positive experience, and we're looking forward to Linux Users Victoria joining as well. So I think it's been a fairly uncontroversial and largely positive shift.
Yep.
If there's anyone from any of those LUGs that would like to add to that, welcome to. But
oh no, it's just Craig here. I just want to suggest to Paul, I couldn't hear you quite clearly, but it's also a question worth, which I think you just said, worth directing to the LUGs themselves as well.
Yep.
I'm just trying to remember when did... I haven't been to an AGM for a couple of years. When actually did TASLUG become a subcommittee?
Roughly 2012 or 2013.
Does Linux Australia have any record of who the current committee of subcommittee is? Or okay, I'm just wondering, is that should that be updated, given that if it was happened when you were here and you're no longer here, here being Hobart, should that be updated? I guess the other thing is, does Linux Australia go through and make sure that those committees are relevant, yearly, active?
Sorry, Dave, we've got a question from the back, I think. Sorry.
Hi, it's Lana Brindley.
Hi, Lana.
Hidden up the back. I just wanted to ask about the PyCon profit. Was that expected? And if it... I'm up here. Hi.
I can answer that, if necessary. Chris Neugebauer, I was on the PyCon AU subcommittee. From what I understand, there was a catering item in the budget that was counted twice. In the budget, therefore it was not spent twice because that would have resulted in far too much food being purchased, and therefore the money was not spent.
So we shouldn't get riches to fall out.
Can we do that again?
Right. Richard, is that correct, or should I run it down for you?
That's correct.
So it was
a clerical error in the budget. I will run the next.
Just being swamped by questions. Chris is on his way. Yes, okay. Thank you, Chris.
So on the question about whether...
Please say your name first.
Bianca Gibson. On the question about whether the specific logs are active, don't LA require periodic reports from all the subcommittees and events? I'm pretty sure we were getting them when I was on council.
Yes, we do, and I believe there's a URL in there. In the president's report to those, so and as last I checked, they were pretty current. Was it? Is that better? Don't mumble. Thank you. Yes, the we do get reports back from the subcommittees, and they're listed.
So you could be using that to check.
Yes.
So you could be using that to check that they're still active.
Yes.
Hi, Stephen Ellis. Last year's AGM, there was some contention over the way we were working with WordCamp, with the WordPress events. Have things changed in that area, or have I picked up on something else?
Thanks. Good question, Steve. I'm probably best placed to answer that one. So this year we met with Andrea Middleton from WordCamp America. And basically resolved to working more closely with WordCamp over the coming years. We're not sure what form that will take, and as soon as we have further updates on that, we'll come back to the community with those updates. It's envisaged that we will probably work more closely with the WordCamps, so that's the what, but we're just not sure on the how yet. I'm not sure if I've answered your question satisfactorily.
In part, it was questions around the financial relationship, how much money was LA entitled out of the events, what was going to go back to WordCamp USA, and what progress has been made in terms of changing that, because right now we're saying that we've had considerable additional income from the events in 2016, but are we at risk of some of that having to go back to WordCamp?
Good question again. For the 2016 events, none of that profit is expected to go back to WordCamp US. WordCamp would obviously like to have some conversations with us around, how that works in the future. Obviously, the two events that ran this year, from memory, I think one of them ran a profit of $26,000 and the other one ran a profit of about $6,500. Who needs a report? I've got it in my head. The question, of course, there is, what does that arrangement entail? WordCamp still provided sponsorship to both of those events, so they've put in some they've obviously put in some support for those events as well.
John Christensen. Might as well mention the last conference that hasn't been mentioned. LCA last year seems to have made a loss. Is that because of the way things are accounted, or did something...
Sorry. They made a profit. They made a $17,000 profit, okay. But that wasn't the budgeted $35,000 profit. Spreadsheets are hard.
I'm Bradley Kuhn from Software Freedom Conservancy, and we're one of the organizations, very few organizations, that you all chose to give a grant to this year, and I wanted to come by the meeting today and thank you all for that, for making a grant to us. If you go to our website, you'll see while we have a lot of individual supporters, there aren't very many on the list who give a grant that large to us, and it has been a big difference to us, and we really appreciate it. We love this community and that you all are supportive of us, and I have brought, I didn't buy enough for everybody because, well, I don't think you want us to spend our grant on buying you chocolates with your grant money. So out of my own pocket, I bought a small box of chocolates, which I'm gonna present to the officers, I suppose. So thank you so much for giving us the grant.
Well, on behalf of Linux Australia, Bradley, thank you for the chocolates, but perhaps more importantly, thank you for all the work, SFC. We very much appreciate it, and hopefully we've set a useful precedent in our contribution.
Matthew Sengier, just a quick question, going back to the GovHack finances. Do LI have transparency of the itemized expenses and income of GovHack?
Yes, LI can see all of those details. GovHack would prefer that we didn't share them with the entire LA membership.
Hi, I just didn't see it.
Sorry,
hello, I'm Pia. I just didn't see it probably, I'm sorry. But question for Tony, is what's the actual, the running, that's the profit from the year, but what's the bank balance now?
I don't actually know what the bank balance is now because the audit report is all about what the bank balance was at the time the finance was completed, and that's just over $1 million.
Whoa.
Right.
Hey, that's Joshua Hesketh here. I'd like to move a motion from the floor, if I may, to thank Josh Stewart and Kim Weatherall for their continued efforts on lobbying to the government and fighting for what our values are and for all the hard work there with sincere gratitude.
Yeah, I'll happily second that.
I will second that motion.
I got in first, sorry. A very, very brief procedural thing which I was meant to do at the start. If you haven't already, but certainly before you go, please sign the attendance sheet if you're comfortable doing so. That just assists with our record keeping. Any further questions before I get to the chocolates?
No, we have to vote on that motion.
I
can't just clappy clap.
Oh. I think the applause pretty much carried it unanimously. Any against? One troublemaker, any abstentions? Any further questions from the floor? Otherwise, I think nothing seen. All right. I believe the next item of business then is to invite John Oxer, who is our returning officer, to do the electoral side of things. Please welcome John to the stage.
Thank you. And yes, it really is me. I know I don't really look the same. So I am probably going to need some assistance through the procedural aspects of this. Earlier today, I looked at the raw data in MemberDB to check the voting information. So I had a look to see whether there were any duplicate votes or anything that seemed out of order, and everything seemed to be in order to me. I could not find any particular problems with it. So I did not look at the actual results, only the individual voting records. So we shall now find out what the result is. So we have Cathy Reid as president. Vice President Cameron Tudball. Secretary Sarah. So, Treasurer Russell Stewart. And down the bottom, you can see the three remaining. So, we have Hugh Blemmings, David Bell, and Josh Stewart as OCMs. So I'm not sure if this is the appropriate point to do it, but I think we should, I would like to propose a motion expressing our thanks and gratitude to the council for the previous 12 months, for all of the work that they've put in through, in some cases, some personally difficult circumstances. So you'll second that? Okay, so all in favour? Yep. Thank you. Any curmudgeonly people who vote against? We have two against. Any abstentions? Oh, of course we have an abstention. Okay, thank you. That is carried. So now I believe the next step is we hand over to the new president. Is that correct? Procedurally? That would be. Thank you. So please welcome to the stage your new president.
Congratulations.
Wow. I kind of wasn't expecting that result, so thank you everyone, and I'll certainly pay everyone who voted. No, not at all, not at all. Hugh and I very deliberately put a decision in front of this community at the end of last year, and we collaborated on that for a very, very good reason. We wanted you as a community to have a very strong say, a very strong sense of ownership in where you want us as the council to take Linux Australia. And I think given those election results, you've given us a very strong mandate to be able to go and enact some of the changes that we wanted to do to the organisation, to strengthen those foundations, to put us in a very strong operating rhythm to take the organisation forward. Linux Australia has been around now, someone will know the exact amount of years, but it's around 15, 16 years. Linux Australia over the next few years is going to experience incredible changes in our environment, what we're here to do, the people we're here to serve, and I really feel incredibly privileged to be able to take Linux Australia forward from this inflection point. And what I would ask is that, you know, if you have the capacity, if you have the capability, come and help council, jump on a subcommittee, come and help us enact that change. And again, a huge thank you for giving us, you know, your blessing in taking us forward in that direction. Thank you. A request to embarrass the committee in front of everyone. So what I'd like to do, can I get the new council up on stage? I believe that Sarah, Cameron's not here unfortunately, Hugh, David, and Russell, and Josh. So please, please hold back on the rotten fruit. So we're going to be hopefully the people who will take Linux Australia to that next level and take us on the next evolution. I'm sure I speak on behalf of everyone up on stage here. Come give us a call. Come chat with us. Come grab us aside. And you know, if you've got ideas for Linux Australia or there's something that you'd like to do, come have a chat with us. We're not scary. We don't bite.
I move that the membership thank the outgoing council members, namely Cherie Ellis, Katie McLaughlin, Tony Breeds, and Craig McWhirter, for their service to the organisation. Seconded by Josh Simmons.
I count two abstentions there.
In the more traditionally informal way.
Yeah. fine. Oh God, what do I do now? I don't think there's any other formal business for the evening.
One more thing. So I'm also attending again this year as the representative of the New Zealand Open Source Society. I'm on their council again this year. Dave Lane, our president, couldn't attend, so I'm speaking on his behalf. So we just want to say we want to look forward to working alongside Linux Australia into this year. We want to maintain or grow the relationship we built during 2016. And in that form, I'd like to arrange a meeting with Kathy over this week to discuss how we can work more closely going into 2017. I think it's important that we grow those relationships because there's a lot of synergies between Linux Australia and what we're trying to see achieve in New Zealand. So I welcome the new committee and I'm looking forward to working with you, and so does the rest of the New Zealand Open Source Society into 2017.
Thank you. I certainly look forward to working with people across on the East Island.
I'd like to move a motion that we ban the word synergies.
Without further ado, I do believe that's all the formalities for the AGM completed, and I'm standing between you and dinner, which is, you know, not a particularly pleasant place to be standing. So thank you all again for giving up your time to come to the AGM. Thank you for sharing your commitment with LA, and I look forward to working with all of you to take Linux Australia even greater and bigger over the next few years. Thank you.